God your worship. Can I get a witness in here? You don't owe nobody else your worship. You don't owe nobody. And that's why when you and I come to the church on Sunday morning or any other time, you and I ought to come with an exuberant spirit. You and I ought not to come as if God has not done anything for us. But when you look back over your life and look how far God's brought you, the stuff you went through, I would never have made it had it not been for the Lord. Come on, is there anybody in here that can say, I would have died in this a long time ago? I'd have lost my mind a long time ago. I'd have cut something out a long time ago had it not been for the Lord on my side. Come on, don't you think because I don't cuss you out, I can't cuss you out. Don't think because I don't spend any money, don't mean I ain't got no money. It just means God has been good to me. Is there anybody here that can testify? God's been good to me. God has opened up some doors for me. And that's why if God don't do nothing else, then he's already done enough. The fact that he woke me up this morning in my right mind.
God, that is what this text, 1 Kings, is written with the first two commandments in mind. Love the Lord, you that you will worship no other God, that you will not worship any other God, that you won't make any graven images. And what 1 Kings shows us is, especially when it comes down to the story of Elijah against Ahab, it shows us and gives us a, watch this, a theological interpretation. Somebody shout, theological interpretation. What does that mean, brother preacher? That means the writer says that the Israel and Judah got punished, and there's a reason why they got punished. And that is to say that God did what he did because the people acted the way they acted. In fact, when you read, watch this, when you read 1 Kings all the way to 2 Kings, you will discover that there was kings after kings in Israel, and they followed in the way of Jeroboam. Somebody shout, Jeroboam. That is to say, brothers and sisters, that when Solomon died, his son Rehoboam took on as the king, and the elders said, listen, your father Solomon accepted taxes, now lighten our burden for us. And Rehoboam said, no, I'm gonna make your burden even harder. And so the 11 tribes, they went and elected a person by the name of Jeroboam. Now Jeroboam was an insecure leader, because what he did was, before the division of the kingdoms, everybody went to Jerusalem to worship. But because Jeroboam was insecure, he said, I don't want folk to go to Jerusalem, because if they go to Jerusalem, they're not going to come and worship where I do. They're going to get allegiance. It's going to be taken from me. And so what he does is he establishes a shrine in Bethel and Dan, and king after king, they lead the people further and further into a hole. Can I tell somebody that if the blind lead the blind, both gonna fall up in the ditch? Be careful who's leading you. Can I get a witness in here? And especially in this so-called United States of America, where we have a divisive dictator in office who only divides his people. Righteousness exalted a nation, but sin is a reproach to any. I wish I could preach like I feel. And so we come to the story of Ahab. He follows after his father Omri. Now Ahab does something more wicked than his predecessors. He goes to a city and country.
country, city, and territory. He goes outside of his race, goes outside of his religion, and begins to marry a woman by the name of Jezebel. God have mercy. And brothers and sisters, I wish I could stay right there, but you better be careful of the Jezebels in your life. I might as well just go, while I'm right through here, I might as well go and say that there's some Jezebels up in church. Now, I'm not talking about Jezebels that sexually entice you, but I'm talking about Jezebels that will influence and manipulate you. Be careful that who you allow yourself to get attached to, because if you get attached to the wrong joker, that joker will help or move you further away from God. Your neighbor said, be careful of the Jezebels. Watch them Jezebels. Brother Rush, come on, they look good. And can I tell you something? When I talk about Jezebels, now I'm not just talking about a person, but I'm talking about an influence, a spirit. Because there's some men that got Jezebel. Can I get a witness? There's some folk that are manipulative. There are some folk that will influence. There are some folk that will talk and that will wreak havoc in the church. That wasn't in my sermon. Let me move. Let me move. That wasn't in my sermon. Let me move. Let me move. That was just a commercial break. Look at your neighbor. Say commercial break. Let me move. Let me move. And so, brothers and sisters, here it is. Here it is. That Brother Terrence, here it is. What I discover, what you discover, what you read in 1 Kings, the end of chapter 16, is that Jezebel influenced Ahab to go and do his own thing, to lead the people further down a road of disaster. He made them worship Baal, who was supposed to be the god of rain, the god of weather, the god who's supposed to, you know, just make everything good, the god of creation. But here it is, God said, I had enough of this. And in chapter number 17, here's a man by the name of Elijah. We don't hear nothing about his call to ministry. We don't know nothing about his history. We don't know nothing about his pedigree. He just comes up on the scene and starts preaching. Can I tell somebody something? That, listen, when God has an assignment for you, it's not about your pedigree. It's not about where you come from. Because when God has a purpose for your life, listen, it don't matter whether you qualify. Listen, God don't call the qualified, but he will qualify the called. If you're called by God, he will put you in a place of greatness. You don't have to sit there and try to seek promotion, because promotion comes not from the east nor the west, but God is the judge. He puts down one and sets up another. Listen, I ain't got to let myself up, because your gift will make room for you. Can I get a witness in here? When the right time comes, God will put you right before the right people. So Elijah comes filled. Brother Archie, God, he comes. And the Bible makes clear that he says, I'm sorry, he says that Ahab, Sister McCafferty, Sister Ruby, says, as the Lord liveth, there shall not be dew nor rain. So now, mind you, what Yahweh is doing, God is issuing a challenge to Ahab. You're supposed to be worshiping a God in control of creation. I want you to see what your God going to do if I shut up heaven. Hey, God, help me preach. I want to see what your God going to do if I sit right there and cause a drought in the land. Let's see if your God can make rain come from out of heaven. Let's see if your God can cause the rain to come on the grass and produce vegetation. Let's see whose God is God. But then, watch this. I love this part of the text, because when God calls Elijah, watch this, brothers and sisters. I like this. After Elijah does and says what God says, and God says to him, Elijah, I'm going to protect you from the drought. He says, so here's what I want you to do. I want you to go east of the Jordan, and I want you to go by a brook. And there I've called, watch this, some ravens to feed you. Lord, have mercy. Then watch this branch. Then God says, you're going to drink from the brook. And the Bible makes clear. Can I preach like I feel? Let the church shout hallelujah. Shout hallelujah another time. And so the storyline goes. Thank you, Jesus Christ. Elijah, the ravens came day after day, evening after evening, and fed him bread and flesh, and he drank from the brook. But because of the drought, my God, the brook began to dry up. Let the church shout hallelujah. And so what is that to say? God said, listen, servant, there comes a place now where your blessing, when the resource, when the brook will dry up. But then God says, hey, listen, Elijah, just like I provided for you this time, I will send you somewhere else. Oh, I love that. What God says is, listen, I don't want you to look now. I want you to get from the brook. Now, watch this. He sends him to a place called Zarephath. Somebody shout Zarephath. Now, Zarephath is in the territory of Sidon. Now somebody said, what that mean? Here's what that means. Here's what that means. Sidon is where Jezebel came from. That was her home country. And so God sends the prophet into Jezebel's